about to commence our program for the evening. I invite you to stand as I invite the Honorable J. Everton Weeks to do the opening prayer.
Let us pray. Almighty, everlasting, omniscient God, whose mind unaffected by the limitations of time, instituted annual religious festivals, seasons, and events for your people to commemorate lest they forget your supreme acts in salvation history, with Jesus Christ being the ultimate revelation. Lord, the human memory is short. Constantly, we need reminders of important events, occasions, and personages who indelibly impacted our lives and circumstances. Gracious God, we offer thanks for this second annual Archbishop, the Most Reverend Sir George Cuthbert Manning Woodruff Memorial Lecture on the occasion of the 51st anniversary of Bishop's College, Kingstown. As we fondly remember a beloved bishop, priest, and pastor who blazed a trail for our present Caribbean church leaders. In short order, we will sit at the feet of Canon Isaiah Philip, guest lecturer, as he presents the role of the Anglican Church in the emerging Caribbean civilization to commemorate the life, ministry, and witness of Archbishop Woodruff, the first indigenous bishop of the Diocese of the Windward Islands and Archbishop of the Province of the West Indies. As St. Paul sat eagerly listening to Professor Gamaliel and Paul's disciples at his feet in the lecture hall of Tyrannus at Ephesus, may all clergy and people, present or listening, be enlightened, encouraged, and emboldened to leave all upper rooms to face, tackle, help solve the myriad social, economic, political and spiritual problems confronting our Caribbean region on a daily basis through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
I ask that you remain standing, please, for the National Anthem of St. Vincent and the Grenadines, which will be done by the students of the Bishop's College, Kingstown. Thank you. seated. Feel free to applaud the youngsters in appreciation. The Right Reverend C. Leopold Friday, Bishop of the Windward Islands. The Very Reverend Patrick McIntosh and Mrs. McIntosh. Archdeacon, the Venerable J. Everton Weeks and Mrs. Weeks. Members of clergy and their spouses. The lecturer, Canon Isaiah Phillip. Principal of the Bishop's College, Kingstown, Miss Cecilia King. Staff and students of the Bishop's College, Kingstown, Mr. Andrew Woodruff. I wish to welcome you this evening to the second in the lecture series. This evening's topic is the role of the Anglican Church in the emerging Caribbean civilization. However, the task is assigned to do the official welcome this evening to the Very Reverend Patrick McIntosh, and I invite him now to bring you the official welcome as we welcome the Speaker of the OACS, Madame Miranda Batiste. Good evening and welcome.
The Right Reverend C. Leopold Friday, Bishop, the Venerable Everton Weeks, the Reverend Canon Isaac Phillips, all clergy, Principal of Bishop College, members of staff, students, invited guests, welcome to all. This is the second annual memorial lecture in the honor of the late Archbishop, the Most Reverend Sir George Cuthbert Manning Woodruff. Last year at the inaugural annual memorial lecture, we heard from the Archbishop of the Province of the West Indies, the Most Reverend Dr. the Honorable John W. D. Holder, who is also the Bishop of Barbados, on the relevance of Anglicanism in the contemporary Caribbean. In my welcome speech, I alluded to one of the truths of Anglicanism, which is the incarnational spirituality that reveals cooperation between God and humanity, God and nature, and between the sacred and secular. And I said that such faith, when practiced in the contemporary Caribbean, along with other spiritualities such as redemptive and ecclesial, will surely help to transform our Caribbean civilization for the future good. This year we are here to hear of the role of the Anglican Church in the emerging Caribbean civilization. Our lecturer, the Reverend Canon Isaac Phillip, Rector of St. Peter with Holy Trinity, St. Peter's, St. Kitts, Diocese of the Northeastern Caribbean and Aruba, NECA. Canon Phillip was the preacher at Bishop Friday's consecration in 2006. And Canon Phillip and myself represent our respective dioceses of NECA and the Windward Islands on the Provincial Commission on Ministry. And as members of that commission, we are very much aware that ministry is shaped by mission, which is the mother of theology. We must not lose sight of the truth that Anglicanism is a tradition within Christianity, and its faith is founded on the Bible scriptures containing all things necessary for salvation: reason, the intellect, and the experience of God and tradition, the practices and beliefs of the historical church. These have influenced Anglican self-identity and doctrinal reflection. When we come to reflect on the theme of the lecture, perhaps no other ecclesia understands emergent better than Anglicanism, for it was able to navigate a middle way between the emerging traditions of its time, which is very much expressed in description Catholic and Reformed. Its history of theology begins with the theology of mission, and much of who we are today have been shaped by our history of mission. We have held the model that the church is the body of Christ. It is the starting point of the goal of mission. God's salvific work precedes both church and mission. We should not subordinate mission to the church, nor the church to mission, but should rather be taken up into the Missio Dei, God's mission, which is the overarching concept of the role of the Anglican Church in the world. Therefore, the primary task of the church in mission is to be God's saving or salvific instrument in his world. One mission of the one God in the one world. It must be sacramental, sign, an instrument of community with God and unity among people, presenting it not imperiously but humbly, not as elite or exalted souls, but as a servant community, serving in the power of the Holy Spirit and the community of the faithful. With these perspectives, the role of the Anglican Church in the emerging Caribbean civilization is to reveal the missionary nature of its calling by having a deeper involvement in education, the family, social programming, community, engagement in efforts of outreach and evangelization, reform, spiritual and religious research, moral and spiritual guidance, social justice, peace and love, unification of the church, and interfaith activities. Tonight, we are called in to listen to the role of the Anglican Church in the emerging Caribbean civilization. And now I ask you to mark, to learn, inwardly digest this lecture to be presented by the Reverend Canon Isaac Philip. Again, welcome to all.
Thank you very much, Dean McIntosh. We will, at this time, provide you with some entertainment. Please applaud, as they will provide us with entertainment this evening, the students of the Bishop's College, Kingstown. Thank you. Thank you very much, students. And never mind, they're so tall, they're quite young, because I know quite a lot of them. So don't be fooled by their height at all. This lecture this evening is, of course, the second annual lecture. And to give us some additional information in terms of the person to whom it's dedicated, I invite the Right Reverend C. Leopold Friday, Bishop of the Windward Islands, to present the profile of Archbishop Woodruff. Bishop.
The Very Reverend Patrick McIntosh and Mrs. McIntosh, the Venerable J. Everton Weeks and Mrs. Weeks, the Reverend Canon Isaiah Phillip, members of the clergy and their spouses, Principal of Bishop's College, Kingstown, Mrs. Celia King, members of staff and students, brothers and sisters all, the Most Reverend Sir George Cuthbert Manning Woodruff, KBE MADD, was born on the May 17, 1918, to George and Evelyn Woodruff of Belmont, St. George, J's Grenada, and was baptized and confirmed at the St. George's Parish Church, Church Street, St. George's. His primary education was at the St. George's Anglican Junior and Senior Schools, Church Street, St. George's, commonly referred to in those days as Jakey School, after the principal, Mr. Jacobs. His secondary education was at the Grenada Boys Secondary School. Upon completion of his secondary education, he was employed as a customs officer in St. George. During this time, he also played in the Harmony Keys Orchestra and was sometimes the organist at St. George's Parish Church, Grenada. And I'm told that during this period, while he was sometimes organist at St. George, his friends made a bet with him or challenged him that he would not be able to play calypso in church and the organ. And so one Sunday, he actually did. Archbishop Woodruff studied for the priesthood at Codrington College, Barbados, in the early 1940s. In those days, the college was affiliated to the University of Durham, England. He was ordained at the St. George's Cathedral, Kingstown, St. Vincent and the Grenadines, as a deacon on the 4th of April, 1944, and as a priest on the 12th of February, 1945, on Shrove Tuesday, Carnival Tuesday, Mardi Gras. And he would say that on that day, as he was presented to the bishop to be ordained, a band passed down back street and his feet were itching to go out. He served in the Archdeaconry of St. Vincent and the Grenadines for a short period after his ordination, and then migrated to Barbados in the latter part of the 1940s, where he served in the following positions: Vicar of St. Simon, Rector of St. Andrew's Parish Church, Rector of St. Joseph, and rector of St. John's Parish Church. During his time in Barbados, he was also a master at Lord's School, St. John. He was invited by Bishop Harold Pigott to return to the Diocese of the Windward Islands in 1967 and was appointed rector and subdean of the cathedral. He became the first local bishop of the Diocese of the Windward Islands and was consecrated on the 29th of September 1969 and served in this position until 1986. He was also the first indigenous archbishop of the church in the province of the West Indies, following his appointment in 1980 until he retired in 1986. He was knighted and also received an honorary doctorate from the University of the West Indies. He served as bishop and archbishop during a time of black consciousness, self-identity, self-reliance, independence, political and ideological debate, and experiment in the West Indies. In the Diocese of the Windward Islands, he led us through the Grenada Revolution of April 1979 to October 1983. Through it all, he guided the diocese and province with calm, dignity, humility, and honor. Archbishop Woodruff was a man of deep devotion and prayer. He said the Anglican office of morning and evening prayer and the Roman breviary daily. People traveled from different parishes in Barbados to listen to his inspiring, thought-provoking, and enlightening sermons, for he was known as a good preacher and teacher. As Bishop of the Diocese of the Windward Islands, he viewed the members of the clergy as his own son and sought to relate to them as a father. He was one who always sought to resolve matters in a calm and peaceful way and suffered fools gladly. Above all, Archbishop was a man of great humor and humility. He never forgot his humble beginnings, and he welcomed and embraced all, those who sat on thrones, and even those who had nowhere to lay their heads. Although he became Archbishop of the Church in the province of the West Indies, he was ever conscious of his humanness, his mortality, and his dependence on God. He was a man of great diligence and care. Archbishop Woodruff died on Thursday, November 29, 2012. The first local bishop of the Diocese of the Windward Islands, the first indigenous archbishop of the church in the province of the West Indies. Archbishop Woodruff is deemed by many to have been a holy and godly man, who touched the lives of many persons in a positive way and gave us an example of what it means to be a follower, a disciple of our Lord. With this in mind, this annual lecture is held in his honor and memory. I'd also like to acknowledge the Honorable René Baptiste and Andrew Woodruff, his son. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Partnering with the diocese is the Bishop's College, Kingstown, and to bring you the remarks this evening, we invite the principal of the Bishop's College, Kingstown, Ms. Cecilia King, after which we'll invite the staff of the school to bring us their entertainment piece for the evening. Bishop Rodoro. Oh, I'm so excited about okay. The Right Reverend Leopold Friday, Bishop of the Windward Islands. The Very Reverend Patrick McIntosh, Dean of the St. George's Cathedral and Chairman of the Board of Governors of Bishop's College. Archdeacon Everton Weeks, members of the clergy and their spouses. Reverend Canon Isaac Phillips, the feature speaker. The Reverend Canon Isaiah Phillip, our speaker, members of staff of Bishop's College, Kingstown, Andrew Woodruff, the Honorable René Baptiste, ladies and gentlemen, good afternoon. I'm a product of Bishop's College, Kingstown, and so it was personally gratifying to be associated with the school as the inaugural lecture was part of the 50th anniversary celebration and brought to the fore the church-school relationship. Additionally, our staff and student body was integrally involved. Archbishop Cuthbert Manning Woodruff had a love for education and sought to ensure the sustainability of Bishop's College, Kingstown. His recruitment policy brought to the school persons like Mr. Lennox John at the head to realize his vision and to place the school on a sustainable footing. We have a tremendous legacy to carry on as the only remaining Anglican secondary school in the state. We know the tremendous strides the school has made in terms of student population. For example, in the 1980s, we had under 300 children. Today, the school population is 440. We have expanded our academic curriculum and now offer 4 science subjects. Additionally, we have enhanced the physical plant with additional 5 classrooms in the last 4 years. Consequently, we have been able to utilize our space to accommodate a library, a music room, making our school high on the list of choices for secondary school. In May each year, we worship at an Anglican church closest to the students' home, and we also focus on a particular parish. This year, our focus will be in St. Paul's in Calicor. I must mention that the houses are named in honor of the bishops of the Anglican Church. We have Piggott, Jackson, Woodruff, and Friday houses. There is a keen rivalry at our sporting events, especially at our annual inter-house championships. A house started 5 years ago with the name Friday, won this year's championship for the first time. We must acknowledge that it went right down to the very last event of the day. Bishop Friday has not missed the staging of the Interhouse Championship, and the look on his face as Friday House was announced as champions was priceless. But, ladies and gentlemen, I have been assured by the members of Woodruff House that Friday will not be repeating the feat. Sorry, Bishop, hope I still have my job tomorrow. Okay, thank you.
This evening, we would like to pay tribute to a visionary, prayerful, and humble man of God. Ladies and gentlemen, the initial lecture was conceptualized as a part of the school's 50th anniversary, but it is clear that henceforth it is an event to look forward to on the lecture circuit of St. Vincent, the annual Archbishop Woodruff Memorial Lecture. I'm glad that you are here. May our time together be a memorable one. Thank you.
Thank you. My only regret is that you only did one piece, and so I am going to put you on warning that you owe us another piece before the evening is over. So please put it together and conceptualize and tell us which one you'll perform for us. But that was very good, and I thank you very much. Nice blend of voices, I'm sure you'll agree. Of course, this evening we're here for a specific purpose, and of course it is a lecture, and to have a lecture, we must have a lecturer. And my task this evening is to introduce this evening's speaker. Canon Isaiah Phillips is a citizen of St. Kitts and Nevis. He was employed with the government of St. Kitts and Nevis as a mail sorter and a specialist teacher of modern languages from the period 1977, I'm assuming, to 1983. Wow. He has held positions such as executive secretary, project coordinator with the St. Kitts Christian Council, diocesan youth coordinator, and youth priest coordinator. Diocese of the Northern Caribbean and Aruba Parish Priest of St. George's, the Commonwealth of Dominica, religious education teacher, Portsmouth, Dominica. He was the priest in charge of St. Michael's, Handsworth. In 2004, he was teaching in the Fellow of Faculty of Religion and Theology at the University of Exeter in the UK. In terms of his community and ecumenical involvement, in 1979, he was the Anglican Youth Representative on the St. Kitts Christian Council. 1984 to 1985, the Executive Secretary, Chief Program Officer, and Projects Coordinator of the St. Kitts Christian Council. Theological Reflection Consultant to Sub-Regional Gathering on the Reorganization and Expansion of Funding Sources for the Caribbean Ecumenical Movement in 1994 to 1985, of course, among many other things. He holds a Master of Philosophy, a BA, a diploma, of course. And ladies and gentlemen, it is my distinct honor and pleasure to invite to the lectern, of course, this is a lectern and not a podium, to invite to the lectern this evening the Reverend Canon Isaiah Phillip, Rector of St. Peter with Holy Trinity, St. Peter's, St. Kitts, Diocese of the North, Eastern Caribbean, and Aruba.
Well, thank you very much, Leon. And I dare say that if I was listening to them present that person, I would feel they have something good to say. So thank you very much for that wonderful introduction. And ladies and gentlemen, before I begin, I want to ask Bishop to permit me to adopt the protocol which our chairperson so ably, you know, laid out at the beginning of the proceedings. And I want to pause just to say thanks to you, Bishop, and your dear wife for your hospitality, and also to Archdeacon J. Everton Weeks and Mrs. Weeks for your hospitality over in Bekwe. And I want to thank Father Francis and Father Jones for today's hospitality. You know, you all have been wonderful. You have made me feel so much at home. You know, I've sometimes said, maybe I need to come across this side. So, ladies and gentlemen, basically, I want to give you a little background to how we ended up at this topic. You know, as I move around the Caribbean region, which is really my own region in terms of my own life moving around the Caribbean, you know, first in community and NGO organizations, dealing with justice issues and, you know, the removal of poverty and so on. And as I go around from day to day, in my own time now in ministry, you know, one of the things that touched me very deeply and dearly is I listen to the talk shows. I do listen to them. It helps me to be critical of myself and my world that I live in. And sometimes I get, you know, there is so much negative that sometimes I feel very downhearted about it. And so I say, you know, sometimes we as Caribbean people, we don't treat ourselves enough in terms of the progress that we have made. Because when I look at where we have come from and so on, I think that we are truly building
a Caribbean civilization. And so that is how we got to the topic. And I'm going to, in my own approach to this tonight, I would look at where we have come from, and I'm going to sort of look at where we are, picking up some of the things that are dear to my own heart and my own life. And then in terms of where we are going, I want to look at those and some of the challenges, and I'm going to try and speak to how the Anglican Church, in terms of its theology, the Anglican Church in terms of its modus operandi, the Anglican Church in terms of its doctrine, you know, can interface with some of those and help us to do them in the most positive way possible. And so that would be my basic approach. And so I want to start with a very brief sketch of where we have come from. And I would, as I say, zero in on aspects of where we are in this emerging Caribbean civilization and what I consider to be some of the paramount challenges. And my family in Christ, any reading of Caribbean history from the social location of Caribbean people, because there are readings of Caribbean history from other social locations. And you know, I've had the opportunity of living and working in the United Kingdom. And you know, I've, believe it or not, but I've heard historians who talk about the generosity of the British Empire in dismantling slavery. You know, and so you know, in terms of reading history from our social location as Caribbean people, you know, we can dispute the fact, whether we're reading, whether it's Brathwaite and the people who came, or Gardening, the making of the West Indies, or Williams in the, from Columbus to Castro, or C.L.R. James in the Black Jacobins, wherever our readings are, one of the things that hits us powerfully is the fact that the postmodern history, the postmodern Caribbean society and civilization that we are constructing has emerged out of a series of crises, a whole series of crises. And brothers and sisters, I want you to remember that the beginning of European connection with our Caribbean region really came out of the European crisis of being unable to maintain their populations on their own resources. And that's one of the fundamental things about Caribbean, the emergence of our Caribbean civilization. It has come out of a series of crises that are not of our own making. You know, people have created those crises for us. And so, as we look, one of my own colleagues in theology, in Caribbean theology, Dr. Cartwright Davis, speaks of four defining crises out of which Caribbean societies came. And remember that original crisis in the 15th century, the 16th century, of poverty in Europe, the Europeans' inability to maintain their populations and societies on their own resources. And it released a whole, you know, movement of mercantilism that brought them to the Caribbean to exploit its resources and its peoples. And you know, even today we're still suffering some of that exploitation. But all the machinations and everything that came out of that early mercantile movement left us with a region that is characterized by six powerful and very, you know, sometimes destructive and difficult to overcome crises in our societies. And the first one is we got a Caribbean community that was affected by persistent and structured poverty. And it was a region, our region was one of constant migration in between 2001 and 2004. I worked in Birmingham in the United Kingdom, and people whom my parents spoke of as I grew up, it was the first time in my life I was seeing them face to face. And you know, I was nearly 50 years. Caribbean migration was deep, Caribbean migration was strong, and Caribbean migration was far-reaching. And then we, in Caribbean societies, we have always, very often, we have always had this kind of ambivalence with ourselves. You know, ambivalence, we are sometimes, we're not quite sure if we can embrace who we are, and so we exist in a kind of a flux. You know, this cultural alienation. You know, some of the questions that the Christian church answered long ago, that you never had to become part of the culture of the people who evangelize your community in order to embrace Christianity. Even today we are still struggling with that. And there are some people who think that you have to be, you know, American, or you have to be British in order to be good Christian. And so, you know, we're still struggling with that. So this is cultural alienation that we continue to struggle with. And brothers and sisters, you know, Dr. Eric Williams, writing in the History of Trinidad and Tobago, said that, you know, almost 50 years after emancipation, a governor of Trinidad said, you know, a race has been freed through emancipation, but a society has not been formed. Dependence has been deepened, and we have suffered from that in the Caribbean, this deep dependence. You know, and that dependence was, in a very real way, that dependence was locked into the European economic system. And as if sometimes they were soothing their guilt for having exploited us terribly. You know, they paid us one load of money for our sugar and bananas that was beyond the market price, you know, and locked us into some trade relations with them that, you know, globalization have, you know, now dismantled. And in a very real way, maybe it's helpful to us. And you know, we have suffered as a people who have gone through colonialism, in the sense that, you know, one of the things that colonialism thrives on is to divide people among themselves. And fragmentation has been part and parcel of our Caribbean heritage. And brothers and sisters, I want to say to you that we have to pay a lot of attention to our own democratic systems that we have inherited, because, I mean, the internal fragmentations and the levels of fragmentation that I am seeing and experiencing as we practice our democracy, they're deadly. You know, they're deadly. And so, and then, you know, because of where we are, and so on, we are in a disaster belt. And because of where we are, in a very strategic position in the Caribbean, you know, linking South and North America, we got caught up in something else. All part of these crises that we don't create. And so disaster has been attached to the whole business of the movement of narcotics. Disaster and the narcotics trade, the transshipment, those are some of the things. Now what have we done with these? And this is where sometimes we need to understand that we have done well as Caribbean people. What have we done with all these things that we have inherited? Our emerging Caribbean civilization has done well in the postmodern era. I'm not saying we have done all that we can do. There is always room for improvement and for moving on. You know, I went to an all-boys school in my primary days, Bastia Boys School, and we had an old headmaster who was an Anglican lay reader in those days, you know, and lay reader meant what it really meant then. He was a lay person who read the scripture in church, because, you know, few people could read, and they selected these people who read, and he was one of those. And, you know, he always said that life is like a ladder, and you're climbing up, going on this ladder. And as we think of our lives as Caribbean people and our movement in terms of what we are doing and the improvements we are making, think of it in this way. As development is like this ladder, and at the bottom you have this big crowd. He says, move on, there's room at the top. And so in spite of all that we have done, I don't want us to get complacent. We need to move on. There are places we can go still, and we have to go. And so we have made remarkable strides, and in dramatically decreased poverty. We have dramatically decreased poverty. And this has been done through education and the development of community infrastructures. I mean, you know, in my deep connections with the church, you know, really came out of my community work. I mean, the CCC were keeping work camps, and we were billing hard court and all kinds of things. And, you know, it is within that context of building community that I was drawn into the life of the church, and, you know, meeting up at conferences, and we have big argument about what kind of worship we're going to have when we meet in these work camps and so on. And, you know, that's the kind of a way. But, you know, you involvement in building communities, and we have done a lot of that expansion, and the expansion and reach of our education is tremendous. I mean, the University of the West Indies, we have moved from a situation where we had what we had were, you know, extramural department, continuing studies department. We have moved now to an open campus, and, you know, increase and expand the width and the possibilities and opportunities for education, and that is tremendous. And, you know, through things like OECS education reform, we have done a lot of work. And in terms of poverty alleviation, the CDB has a wonderful program. The BNTF, Basic Needs Trust Fund, that deals with building community infrastructure, building human resource capacity, and all is done in a way of targeting vulnerable communities and vulnerable groups and persons. And so we've really made strides. Our region, so much so that our region has emerged in the World Bank and IMF evaluation that we have moved from low income to middle income and higher income nations. That sometimes, you know, with the monies we want to do things, and we want to get them a cheap money, you know, you get money to borrow and you pay low interest rate. We can't get, because we have made progress. And we have to, you know, understand that we have done that, and stop so very often, you know, knocking ourselves as if we haven't gotten anywhere. We have gotten somewhere. Maybe it's not far enough, but we have gotten somewhere. And in terms of migration patterns, and I travel and I go around St. Vincent, and they say to me, you know, you see those houses up there? Those people there used to live in England, they used to live in the US, they come back home and so on, you know. Migration patterns change. People coming back now to the Caribbean. And they are coming and they are bringing vital skills and resources to help to build the region. You know, and all of these are things, this is what we have done. Remember, we got a situation where people couldn't wait sometimes to get out of the Caribbean, you know. And stories are told of how we got out of the Caribbean in all kinds of ways, you know. And they say people used to stow away on these ships, you know. And this gentleman, he goes down and he go down and, you know, there's this hole in the ship and, you know, they have the stowaway officer searching and he see the gentleman coming and he slipped down and slipped on the cover and the gentleman saw him, you know, so he passed a little bit, then he sat on the cover, you know, and after a couple of minutes he started now. He said, somebody in there, you know, that was the nature of us. I mean, you were rushing to get out of this region and hiding away on ship and all kinds of things, but no, there's a big change. A lot of our people are returning. A lot of our people who are go away and studies and so on, they are returning because we are building and we are doing the kinds of things that they can find a place in our societies. And then in terms of our own cultural alienation, I mean, acculturation and enculturation have always been issues in all societies, you know. We are cultures are fighting to expand themselves and their cultures are clashing with each other, but the Caribbean is very special. And you know, we had that situation where even now, you know, in some Caribbean societies, we still find people who finding it difficult to embrace our own cultural heritage. I mean, you know, but thanks be to God, I mean, almost every Caribbean society I've been in the last 10 years, they have some form of carnival or some local festival, something that they're embracing this whole business of taking seriously the fact that, you know, this is part and parcel of our life, the cultural systems that we have. There are systematic attempts to deal with, you know, sort of embracing and not just embracing and celebrating our cultural heritage, but expanding it. And you know, I was just a couple months ago at a workshop, you know, as part of the Christian Council, you know, and they're talking seriously about, you know, all this thing to do with intellectual property rights for our artists and so on, that people must be able to understand that, you know, you can't just take up our artists' things and rush them on and do all kinds of things with them. You have to acknowledge them and you have to pay them over these things, you know. And so all of this is part of a movement that is celebrating and seeking to preserve and expand the culture that, you know, we share in the Caribbean. And brothers and sisters, in terms of the whole area of dependence, we have to thank globalization sometimes. You know, it has its downside. But you know what, one of the things globalization have done for us in the Caribbean, it has caused us to dismantle a lot of dependent and inefficient industrial systems. And you know, these have given way to more competitive enterprises, and they have also opened up our creativity in terms of seeking ways in which we can find financial and material resources for Caribbean development. And I mean, we have done marvelous on some things. And you know, as we go on and we talk about one of the things that have emerged in, you know, in the wake of globalization is Caribbean societies, and some Caribbean islands have moved into something they call, you know, citizenship by investment. And we'll talk about it, and you know, some of the ethical and social challenges that these things bring to us, but the creativity, and you cannot overlook the creativity of how these things, you know, globalization have unleashed our creativity in such ways. And in terms of the whole business of the inheritance of such a fragmented Caribbean. We have done excellently. You know, we have an Eastern Caribbean dollar. I mean, we have a region where we have an integrated monetary system. Not even the mighty European Union have an integrated monetary system, because Britain still have the pound and they're not going to give it up. All of us, we have our EC dollar that integrate our whole monetary system, you know? And I mean, that is a tremendous thing. We are leading the world in this kind of thing, you know? And so we are not followers, we are leaders. And brothers and sisters, you know, the CSME is really working in the, you know, the Eastern Caribbean single market and economy. You know, I was in Barbados Monday. My passport stamp, it says visitor, 6 months, prohibited to be employed. I come to St. Vincent Tuesday and my passport stamp, well, half an hour, 1 hour away, and my passport stamp, it says OECS National indefinitely. You know? Things working! The system working, man! You know, yes! You know, so, brothers and sisters, we're moving, we're building and moving out of fragmentation, you know. And don't talk about our regional security system. I mean, you know, we have our security people who move around in terms of disaster coordination and management and moving resources in terms of getting, you know, collaboration in overcoming disaster and so on, and they're also working together to improve our whole safety and security. It's a standing thing now that the commissioners of police of our OECS region, they meet up together, you know, and they discuss about how they're dealing with issues of crime, and there's all this collaboration, you know. My son, who works with the police in forensic, he tells me, you know, well, daddy, before you reach St. Vincent, they don't know you're coming, you know. So he said, they don't know you're coming, you know. So they have systems, you know, they're working. And these are things we can be thankful for. And so in the midst of all of this, with what we have done, with what we have inherited, the question is, where are we going? And I want to say to you, my brothers and sisters, that we are building a Caribbean civilization. But it's a civilization that we have to continue to ground it in and to found it upon, and constantly strive to obtain six major goals that we have to seek to promote and to achieve as we build this civilization. And those goals have to do with the crises that we have inherited. We have to continue to seek to try to eradicate poverty. We can't build no civilization where we're going to have people who can't afford to live in our communities and enjoy life as part of that true humanity that God has created in his image and likeness. That's a humanity that is enjoying the best of what we have available within our Caribbean region. And we can't leave some behind and move on with some. You know, we have to create opportunities for all people within the region. We got to build inclusive communities. And as we build inclusive communities, there's something else we have to be very aware of. You know, our populations in the Caribbean are aging. You know, I was telling my son so the other day, you know, I look at all my peers who I went to school with, and they had all grown over and so on, you know, so I start to follow up and look at the information, and they tell me that by 2030, in our Caribbean region, for the first time, the population age 60 plus is going to be at a higher percentage than those between 0 and 15. And that's a tremendous challenge. We have to now create the kinds of inclusive societies and communities. No longer you would go to these churches and we have these huge steps to go up. You know, people like me, me ain't 68, and sometimes they need them hurting. So you could imagine, you know. So we have to create the kind of societies that, you know, you're going to have the infrastructure to deal with that kind of change, the inclusive nature of our societies. We can't just sit down, you know, and think, you know, Sparrow have a lovely calypso. He say, age is just a number. Well, he never so wrong. Age is number plus. And it's the plus you gotta watch. Okay? So we have to create the kind of society. And then the celebration and sort of preservation of our cultural traditions. There's still a certain amount of ambivalence about our cultural heritage among some segments of society. We have to deal with that, you know, and we have to work on stemming the tide of disunity and expanding regional integration. And whatever we do with our societies, we have to make sure that we improve safety and security by curtailing violence. And so these challenges we have to face. How do we face them as we go on this journey? Well, in this process, in terms of all the six of those challenges, the empowerment of the poor, creating opportunities for all people within the region, celebrating and preserving our cultural traditions, eliminating dependence, expanding regional integration, improving safety and security by curtailing violence, we have to be able to garner the resources, financial and otherwise, for the continued development of the region. And brothers and sisters, in garnering those resources, we got to dig down deep into our own creativity. You know, some new non-traditional streams of resourcing have developed financially, and we talk about the whole business of CBIs, citizenship by investment, you know. And most of all, what we have to work on is creating a different mindset in Caribbean society. You know, I go to government offices sometimes, and you know, while they're waiting for service, sometimes not to get annoyed with how they treat me so bad, you know, with the service support sometimes. You engage them in a little conversation, you know, you keep conversation, and they treat you a little nicer, you know. So, you know, you keep good conversation. Say, oh, will you train, and so on and so. And, you know, we have a lot of people sitting down in government offices, answering phone, doing all kinds of things, with masters in business administration, you know, well qualified with masters in business administration then, you know. And as I spoke with one young lady, I remember when, you know, I was going to high school for the first time, just in the early 1970s. And my father said to me, you know, it's a lot of money to get you to this high school. You know, I was living in the country and you got to pay the bus go. You know, I think the bus was $1 or something for the whole week. But that was a whole ton load of money, you know. So he said, you know, a lot of money, you know. And so he said, I'm sending you to high school so you could learn and come out and get a good job. No, he's talking, my son going off to university, years after, going to spend money that I don't have. You know, my father said to him, your parents going to spend a load of money they don't have on you, you know, and they're sending you, when you go and come back, or set up your own business, change your mindset. I never understood it until I was talking to this young lady, and she was saying, you know, our peers talk to us, and you know, and I reflected on that. We have to create that change of mindset, that we are not educating people now to look a job, we're educating people to get involved in setting up business to create wealth. Wealth creation is what we are going towards now. You're not coming out to go look no job, you know, wealth creation. And so, as we think of all of this, how do we get to summon that creative capacity of our people? And brothers and sisters, here is where the Anglican Church and some of its teaching can be brought to be on this situation. You know, in the opening of the Anglican understanding of its faith, in outlining its faith in its prayer book, we talk about who we are as human beings, and we are part and parcel of God's creation. But we are very different from the rest of creation, because we are created in this special way. And we have this lovely biblical phrase, the image and likeness of God. And you know, I love when I'm teaching confirmation, and they say, what that mean, we look like God? You know, and they say, God, they say, but we ain't know God look, nobody don't see God. I say, you have it right, nobody don't see God, we look like God, you know. But part of what that means is we have the capacity of being co-creators with our God. We can be a creative people. And so, as we interface with the emerging Caribbean civilization as the Anglican Church, we ourselves, who are Anglicans, we have to begin to live out this thing, that we are part of that creative being that God has made, and we have that creativity. And so we got to push ourselves to bring out that creative capacity and help our society to embrace that as part of who we are as we move forward in trying to find those resources. And part and parcel of that, created in the image and likeness of God, is the capacity to choose and to make right choices. And so whatever we do, we have to bring a strong ethical dimension to whatever we are involved in. And we got to train our people to embrace that and to hold on to it and to lead our society in embracing and celebrating that new creative Caribbean person who is summoning all the creativity but is putting ethical standards very high on our agenda. And ethical standards cannot thrive in any situations, brothers and sisters, where we don't have transparency and openness. You can't have no ethical standards tried in those places, you know. And I mean, you know, it is then our CBIs, Citizenship by Investment Program, have opened up. And sometimes we don't know one way or the other. We don't even know whether we have a million of them Citizens by Investment, or 2 million, or 10. We need transparency. We need to understand what is happening, and we need to know when funds are collected from those things. We need to have clear transparency as to how those funds are used and everything. You know, we can't sit back and, you know, say, well, that ain't really my business. It is all of us business, and all of us, you know, must bring those ethical standards to be on the situation and on the circumstances. And so, you know, the Anglican deep understanding of human nature, that people are part of God's creation, but special in comparison to the rest of creation. We are created in God's image and likeness, thought, reasoning, creativity, choice, all those dimensions. We must learn to help our people to emerge in that kind of a way. Those are the kinds of people who are going to be able to find within us and the way we do things that capacity to find the resources to take our society where we want to go. And when we are eliminating poverty and creating a society for all, it comes down to our sense of identity. We are God's people in this place. And one of the things, you know, we can bring to bear on that in the Anglican Church is the Anglican self-understanding of who we are and who God is. We are the people of the new covenant. Our God is our incarnate Lord. Our God is in our history. Our God is in our world. And because our God is with us, then we have a responsibility to mobilize people to build inclusive communities where productivity, mutual care, and support are major pillars on which we are building. And brothers and sisters, we can't build no inclusive community where we want to practice racism. We can't build no inclusive community where we want to practice classism. We can't build no inclusive community where we can embrace everybody in spite of the gender and the sexual orientation and all the things that divide us. Not to forget our politics on the local level, because that is one of the most divisive forces that we have to face in the Caribbean, our politics and the local levels. And brothers and sisters, I tell you, you know, politicians are the hardest people to work with. I believe we got to work on our democratic traditions, you know. In Guyana, Forbes Burnham used to call Chedi Jagan the minority leader. I think we got to get away. I think sometimes we take this business of opposition too seriously. You know, we believe that opposition means everything that is done on the other side, we got to break it down. You know, we have to, even if it means some changing up of names and so, we have to find a way to say, well, look, these are the people who are involved in the governance of our nation, and they have to be in constructive engagement with one another so that we can get the best that is possible for our whole communities and for their development and advancement. You know, the whole business of being the people of the new covenant, those people of the new covenant, you don't have restrictions in that new covenant community. And blessed Saint Paul put it very nicely. He said, you know, in Christ you don't have no Jews, no Greeks, no slave, no free, no Gentiles, no, you know, all those things, all those divisions, you know, we break them down and we learn to embrace people. We cannot continue to build a society for all people if we don't debunk and throw away all those divisions, whatever they are. We have to rise above them, you know. And then in terms of celebrating our culture and preserving it, we have to always remember, you know, the well-being of the whole world. You know, coming out of the ecumenical movement, our world belongs to God, and through Jesus Christ, God is carrying on his work of redemption in his world. Redemption not taking place elsewhere, it is in God's world. This is the world that we have to work with God to redeem. And so our own Anglican commitment to Christian stewardship in its widest dimension, where it calls us to manage the whole created order on behalf of its owner, the living God and the sovereign creator. You know, last year something happened to me in my church, and you know, it was such a painful thing. The members of the National Carnival Committee came to my church to worship. They say, well, this is a new thing they're doing, you know. When they launch in Carnival, and so our Carnival is in December, they decide the same week they're going to launch the Carnival activities, they're all going to go to a church and worship. And so they came to my church, and you know, I encouraged them to make sure in the planning of the activities and so on, they do it in a way that it brings out the best of our culture and the best in our people and so on. And then, you know, I top off the thing with some nice prayers that they would have a nice violence free carnival and so on. And they had a little broadcast with some of my colleagues. I tell you, my phone won't stop ringing this Sunday. These fellows who the ecumenical movement from, you know, the evangelical and Pentecostal tradition, the fellows cussing hell, you know, they said, you know, it's as if, as far as they were concerned, it's like I was promoting this devil team. You have them fellows here in the church, and you're treating them so nice, and so on and so forth. And so, you know, we have this ambivalence about culture that somehow, you know, them, they're devil teams, and we're not supposed to have nothing to do with them. I said to them, well, you know, brothers, we're going to have to discuss this thing, you know. But it was very painful to me. I mean, one of them actually went on the radio the next day, and he went out with so much things, you know, that people say, why are you doing? I say, not a thing. I mean, not a thing. He just vexed that I caused the carnival. But, you know, and so we have to, you know, sort of come to that place where we understand Christ and culture. That, you know, Christ is not necessarily against culture, but we got to take the Christ to that culture to bring transformation to the culture. That is what we got to do. And we can't bring transformation by sticking outside there. You know, Reverend Dr. Leslie Litt once told the story when he worked for the ecumenical community, that they had this thing with the Russian Orthodox Church. And you know, this was the church under communism, you know, these fellows living under communism. And you know, he says everything that the community have, the Russian Orthodox Church there, you know. And we said, these fellows, you're all managing, going on with all these things, and people, they're cussing out God, and you're right there in the middle of it. And the fellows say, you can't bring transformation from outside. You got to be inside. Take the living God in there to bring the transformation to take place from inside there. And that's what we got to do with the culture. We got to get in, you know, and let the transforming power of God work its way in that. And that's all part and parcel of our deep understanding that we are stewards of God. God has given us his world with all that is in it. And we have a responsibility to work with God to manage that it becomes under God's redemptive and transformative influence. And brothers and sisters, you can't do it by sticking out there and staying off out there. And so I go everywhere. Every place I go to. And you know, there is nothing that is off limits for me. You know, a fellow once called me, tell me, I'm setting up a little thing, you know, Reverend, and when the boys, them, you know, feel their head getting heavy and they want a little release, you know, so he say he's setting up a little place and he want me to come bless it, you know. So, you know, so I say, well, I guess, what do you mean a little place? Why, you know? He said, nah, you know what I mean? And the boys, them, you know, have the thing and so. And he say, you know something, Reverend? When you have these things here, you don't have no rape in the society, you know. And so on and so forth. So I turned up at this place, you know. I turned up, so I said to him, well, you know, one of the things, I said, not for me, you know, it's all right with me. I say prayers for all people in all circumstances and situations, but you know, if me boss hear anything, I go one, or if you have a license, where you license? He said, well, these things don't license, you know, you ain't no license for this. I say, well, we have a problem, you know. Anyway, walk on the license and call me back. But brothers and sisters, if he had a license, I would have prayed. And I know what I would have prayed for, you know. But he didn't have a license, you see. So, but you know, you don't make anything off limits for the transforming power of God, you know. And I said to him, well, whatever you do, you know, we believe strongly in the rule of law, so get it under the law, man. Whatever you do, you know, so, you know, nothing is off limits when it comes to the transforming power of God, you know. And so well, these days he see me all the time and he say, you see that Reverend there, man, you go call him, you know, anywhere, anytime, he'll be there. I say, that's okay, you know. So, and then, so we have to make ourselves available. Our presence and participation in the cultural celebration of our region are important ingredients in God's transformative work in his world. You know, everything must come under that redemptive influence of Christ. You know, you know, some years ago when I served in a different parish that I'm in now, I've always thought that I'm a very good domino player, you know, and it's about bringing the transformative influence of God. And so I go, and those people who play domino, you know, when you go places to play domino, you know, we go to the days we call the joint, that's where the fellows, you know, they drink up the liquor. And when you're playing domino, I mean, it's not no Sunday school behavior, you know, if you know what I mean. That no Sunday school behavior, and these fellows going on, and you know, my parishioners complain me to my bishop, buddy, you know, and so my bishop don't know how to raise this thing with me. He said, well, you know, you got to be careful, you know, because some people are bothered that, you know, you don't. I say, you think they're going to change me? You know, you think they're going to change me and make me some kind of hedon or something? You know, and I go. So these fellows there, and I always think I can play well, you know, and so I said to them, okay, I'm going to tell you all something. See, we're going to play. Every time I win, everybody got to come church. When I lose, I buy in drinks for everybody, and I'm not telling nobody what to drink. Y'all drink what you want. That's your business. Or you just paying. You know. I go there. You know, so the fellows, they say one thing, Rev. You can't do, you won't send a prayer here when you go on the board. Wherever prayer you say, send them home. You know? So, well, I send me prayers and I go on. Man, this week I give them so much licks. You see these fellows come to church, their face push up. You know what I say? And they arguing with one another. Oh, you all make the reverend bring us church. The transforming power of God, you could take it. You know, my own church that was complaining to the bishop, they paid for the drinks. And they says, well, our priest doing domino evangelism. Never heard the term yet. Domino evangelism, they say, are doing. All these fellows, they tell me, yes, we're trying to get some of these fellows in church. They promise you they never come. I say, well, I, oh, you know, and if they don't come, they have to come twice. They don't come the once when they get, they have to come twice. You know, so we get into the culture and we can, you know, let the transforming work of God work through us. And then we have the whole business of eliminating dependence and enhancing safety and security. Brothers and sisters, in the Anglican Church, we understand that the universe is, the whole universe is the redemptive sphere of God. God is working in redeeming the whole world. God sent his son Jesus Christ to die on Calvary's cross, that we might have life and have it in greater abundance. Our world belongs to its creature, its creator, and all people are called to enjoy it in accordance with God's will. As a consequence of Jesus' work of redemption, God is, which encompasses death on Calvary's cross, culminated in his resurrection and ascension, God has declared that all people, every person, is worthy of the best of his created order. And everything in human society that hinders that, we have a responsibility to teach our people that we must struggle against that. You know that 10:10 passage in John? I came that you might have life and have it in greater abundance. Is a summon for all of us to get involved. I tell young people all the time to work on those things that celebrate and support life and the fullness of life. Nothing that destroy life or that in any way inhibit the enjoyment of life. We have that responsibility because, you know, God is working in his whole universe and we got to work with that. And you know, as we speak to expand regional integration, we have to understand that the fullness of God's presence is known in community. And it is one of the strong things in the Anglican Church. We have a strong belief in the celebration of the doctrine of the Trinity. And this is important in terms of us interfacing with the movement to build and strengthen Caribbean integration. If you want to examine the Anglican liturgical year, it would reveal that 99.9%, I would say, of the way the Anglican Church understand time in terms of its year, are built around events in the life and ministry of Jesus. 99% of everything built around events in the life, and that other 0.1% is significant to note, is dedicated to a doctrine. It's the only place in the church here where you have dedication to a doctrine, the doctrine of the Trinity. And so not this Sunday coming. The Sunday coming is Pentecost, which Sunday, the Sunday after that is Trinity Sunday. The only place in the whole liturgical year where is dedication to a doctrine. And I want to tell you, it is not accidental. It is important for our church. We believe in firmly and truly, and we experience God as a community of persons. Community is important in the fullness of the experience of God. The Father Almighty, who is the powerful and creative manifestation of God's powerful presence. But that same God is also known and has been manifested and experienced in the loving and caring and nurturing presence of Jesus of Nazareth, Jesus the Christ. And you know, the human face of God, if you want to call it that, and that utterly powerful and majestic God is also known in the unseen presence of the Holy Spirit that is here with us even now. And you know, this doctrine is so important to the Anglican Church in terms of understanding this sense of community we are called to, and this sense of community in which we can truly experience the fullness of God's presence and power. You know that Robert Moore is a Guyanese historian, and in speaking of the development of the Anglican Church as a province in 1883, he said, it's just over 130 years ago, in fact 132 to be exact, he says, you know, it's an amazing thing. It's filled with contradiction and all kind of paradox. He says, the Anglican Church in the Caribbean became a province, affirming its unity and its community, when everything around it and everything in its life was saying, you need to be built into the imperial process. You know, Robert Moore calls it, it was the high noon of Victorian imperialism. That's how he puts it. You know, because the year, you know, 5 years after that, the church was at the whole British Empire, of which, you know, the Caribbean was a part, were gearing up for the celebration of the Golden Jubilee in 1888 of Queen Victoria, a time when the pomp and ceremony of empire, you know, would be ritualized in what he called the Pax Britannica. You know, the British government and the British navies, they rule the sea, and British confidence vis-a-vis the stretch of the British Empire, they veritably said the sun never set on it. You know, it's so huge and all encompassed. And he says, in the midst of that, the Anglican Church in the Caribbean affirm itself and say, community is important for us, and we're going to build community. The doctrine of the Trinity, the church itself, with everything that was going on around it, it couldn't escape it owns its own doctrine of the Trinity, its own sense and importance of community. A community, and so that is what we need to communicate to our world, to help our people to understand that in the Caribbean, we have to build community. And I hope that the next time, you know, in a couple of years, when I get to Barbados, me stand and say, you know, CARICOM citizen indefinite. But we need to build on that sense of community, you know. And so the church, yet Caribbean Anglicanism, when there was that dominance of British colonialism, community was so important that they decided to go against the tide of the time and build themselves into a province, which is still going on even up to today. The Anglican province of the West Indies that had been going and going strong for over 130 years. The emerging Caribbean civilization in our modern Caribbean, the modern Anglican church, here in our Caribbean, working in a province, we have much to give and lend to our region in helping us to move and embrace the challenges that we have to face to go to greater heights of success in regional integration. My family in Christ, I know you all want me to finish now, and I'm going to do that, you know. Our emerging Caribbean civilization, we are building a postmodern Caribbean region where all of us have to be involved in making sure that we strengthen the six pillars of our society, which is really reversing the six crises that have really brought us to where we are, you know. And we have to continue to concentrate on empowerment of the poor and the downtrodden, you know. We have to create opportunities for all people. And remember, and I need not forget it, every day I remind myself of it, that our populations are aging, because I'm part of that aging population. And brothers and sisters, in so many ways, I feel me age, you know. Sometimes my wife says, you need a glasses to look for the glasses now. Because, you know, all the signs and things that, you know, this is an aging population. You don't see as well as you used to see before. And so, you know, and we have to remember that, you know, we are a people who have a culture. We are a people who have come out of it. Let us own ourselves. Let us be proud of who we are, and let us hold on to that culture and celebrate it. Where things are not as good as they are, let us work hard to improve it. But let us not continue to alienate ourselves by wanting to treat ourselves as, you know, that is not us. This is who we are. We are people who are just a hybrid, you know, embracing all these bits and pieces and, you know, putting them in a way that they become something that, you know, sort of tell the world who we are. And the question of dependence, we have to continue to work on eliminating dependence, learning to build community, and remember that all of us must work to expand regional integration. And when it comes to, you know, sort of understanding that and going forward, let us remember the Anglican doctrine that God and encountering the fullness of the power of God is about community, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. The Anglican Church in the Anglophone Caribbean, the church in the province of the West Indies, the CPWI, you know, it's very presumptuous the way we name ourselves. We are the church in the province of the West Indies, imagine. We are the only church, you know, we are the church. Everybody else is something else, you know. So we're so presumptuous about ourselves. But as we build community, we don't take ourselves so seriously, you know. We are always in the ecumenical movement and so on, you know. So, you know, but it has a role to play. We bring our life, our theology, our praxis to bear on the process to try and give it some credence and to bring critical support towards achieving our objectives of building a civilization with the very best possible outcomes for all our region's people. And specifically, brothers and sisters, we bring to the table as the Anglican Church in this process. And we can only bring it to the table if each one of us as Anglican own it for ourselves and practice it. We bring our deep understanding of who we are as human beings, part and parcel of God's creation, yet very special in that creation. We are created in God's image and likeness. We bring creativity and we bring that capacity for choice, ethical choices. You know, that is wounding our society a lot. You know, I the other day, you know, I get in this thing, you know, I am always getting myself in things, I must tell you, you know, I get in a lot of things, you know, and, you know, we have this thing and it says that, you know, there must be consultation. And, you know, I am sitting, I consider myself a big educated man, and my father used to say, you're well educated, man, and I take it seriously, you know. And this politician tells me, it says, you must have consultation with this committee. He tell me, call them on the phone. No, he call them on the telephone. So I say, well, let me tell you something, see, I want to see the minutes from the committee meeting, and if I can't see the minutes, there will be a big problem. Because, you know, if it's a committee and you got to consult committee, you have to be able to tell me the committee meet here, you know, this is your agenda. You can't tell me you call people on phone. You know, say you must consult the members by phone. It says you must consult the committee. So I say, you know, I say, this ridiculous thing. You know, where is your ethics? If it's a consult, so, you know, so we got to, you know, challenge these kind of little things. Anyway, he do it over. And so we didn't have no problem, and I call and thank him and tell him, you know, it's the right thing. Money is the same result, but you know, is it, that don't matter. That don't matter. That is the result, the process, you know, the process. The same result, you know. I wasn't questioning the results at all. I just wanted the thing. So, you know, we must bring that, the whole ethical dimension and the Anglican understanding of who we are and how we understand God, that God is in control of everything. And you know, we are God's words, and we must bring that commitment to managing the whole of life, including those cultural things. And you know, that God's redemptive action is going on in the whole of his world. And we got to try and, you know, interface with those things so God could use us in the process. And you know, the whole business of the celebration of the doctrine of the Trinity, reminding us that community. And we bring all of these to the table. I want to tell you, as an Anglican and you go out in the world, and as the Anglican Church, which each one of us represent, we go out in the world to bring these to bear on what we do in the world. I want to tell you something. The Anglican Church, we do our theology, our whole reflection and acting for God and thinking about God and talking about God. That's what theology is about. We do it in a particular way, you know. Dean McIntosh mentioned it, and he puts it the way people usually put it. We use the Latin expression, the via media. The via media. And you know, Dean McIntosh put it the way most people put it. This is a middle way. But I want to tell you something. It's a little more than just middle way. It has to do with taking seriously reality. You know, you got to take seriously reality. And that you can't always compartmentalize people into special and specific places. You know, there are people who within themselves, they are Protestant and Catholic at the same time. That is how that's the way we do our theology. We take in reality that when it comes to people, you can't always compartmentalize them into some small department and say they are this or they are that. Because sometimes there is a whole mixture. And you know, I don't understand why we have so much problems in the worldwide Anglican communion over issues of sexuality. Because genetically you are XY and some are XXY. You know? So, well, that's part of human reality. That's part of the reality. So all of those things, and that is the way we do our theology, we take that seriously. That you can't always, you're not always going to get, you know, some perfect thing or this, the other, that, the, you know, it's a mixture. And you've got to hold on to that mixture and deal with it. And so, you know, the Latin American theologians, they got it right. Very right. You know, because they said, as they were confronting oppression, the Somozas in Latin America and so on, they said, look, when we are working as people of faith to fight injustice and to create real, authentic Christian communities, communities where people truly care for, love, and support each other, we got to understand that what counts in terms of helping in God's transforming power becoming real is what they call orthopraxis. Doing the right thing rather than orthodoxy, which is believing the right thing. It's about doing the right thing and not just believing the right thing. And that is what Anglican theology seek to embrace. You know, it's not just about right belief, is also about right practice. And right practice must take into account the complexity of humanity. And so, brothers and sisters, I want to pray that all of us would stand up as good Anglicans and make our contribution to support the emerging Caribbean civilization. I thank you.